Welcome. So the first speaker today is Alexander Altanovsky. He's going to talk about highly transitive action.
Thank you, and thankful to the organizers. I'm happy to say happy birthday to Ilya. I'm lucky to have joint paper with Ilya, and I know that he's very enthusiastic towards difficult mathematical problems. In particular, 18 years ago, he formulated known problem. It was like a homework to me to construct an infinite finitely presented torsion group. But we think with Mark, we were thinking with Mark quite a long time. Unfortunately, didn't manage to tackle that problem, and so the topic of my talk today is different. on highly transitive actions of infinite groups. The initial definition was given yesterday by Professor Segev, given arbitrary set and arbitrary group acting on this set. We say that action is k-transitive, and if for arbitrary two sets of distinct elements, we have an element of group moving the first set just component-wise to the second one. And we will also assume that the number of elements in X is at least k, so there is at least one such k-tuple. Well, and obvious examples, find example are symmetric group, alternating groups, respectively, n-transitive and n minus 2 transitive groups. well, and if we speak on finite groups, then there are no other examples of k-transitive action, I mean faithful action, so this trivial kernel, this is the definition of faithful action, except for those two obvious examples, symmetric and alternating groups. And I am speaking now on infinite groups only. And an action is called highly transitive. It is if it is k-transitive for every natural k. And a group is called highly transitive if there is at least one phase for highly transitive action of this group on some set. So the group G is isomorphic to a subgroup of symmetric group on this set because the action is faithful. Well, immediately we have some obvious examples. Here the examples are countable because the first group over there is symmetric, not symmetric group, but the group of all permutations with finite support. So this countable group and the subgroup of index 2 in this group is alternating, infinite alternating group. Well, they are not finitely generated, but many finitely generated examples were finite by Bernard Neumann. And the simplest example is the following. We consider one more. We consider this permutation. This permutation on the set of integers, just shift, and add this permutation to the subgroup of fine tree permutations, and this group generated by them is of course highly transitive, because the subgroup is highly transitive, but it is finitely generated. You see that arbitrary permutation of two neighbor symbols belongs to this subgroup, and they generate the group of permutations with finite support. It was observed that in fact in this example our infinite cyclic group generated by sigma can be replaced by arbitrary finitely generated group, arbitrary. So we have many examples of finitely generated highly transitive group between alternating group and the full symmetric group. These examples are highly transitive groups of the first type. Why first type? I will explain later. Now about examples of the second type. The first example was constructed by McDonough, arbitrary free group, non-cyclic free group, admits a faithful, highly transitive action. And in a sense, it was observed later, almost every two elements in the full symmetric group in some probabilistic meaning almost every group almost every subgroup of the symmetric group is free, and there are many examples of this type. And these examples can be generalized to free products. Here, the names of the authors considered free products. So arbitrary non-trivial free products, except for the infinite dihedral group, of course, admits a faithful, highly transitive action. Other examples, almost every surface group, again except for some small surface groups, admits such an action by Kitroza. Just a few years ago, Garion Glasner proved that the group of outer automorphism of the free group of rank 4 or greater is also highly transitive, and the action is in a sense exotic. They considered a special group, a monster, such that infinite monster where arbitrary proper subgroup is cyclic, and consider its direct power, G to M, in this set. This set was considered up to the action of G by automorphisms, natural action. And we should exclude M tuples generated cyclic subgroup. And then we consider Nielsen transformations on this N-tuple, say, if we have G1, G2, and so on, we can replace it by G1 times G2, comma G2, and so on. And such Nielsen transformations induce the action of the group of automorphism. So by the set X is rather unusual, but in all the examples I mentioned, first we have some infinite set, and then we define permutation, we define actions. And the approach I want to discuss now is slightly different. First of all, we observe that arbitrary transitive action is isomorphic, it's well known, to the action of G, right action modulo some subgroup. This is a point stabilizer of this action. And assume that we have such action, and assume that it is not k-transitive, and we have some witness, that is, we have two sets of cosets, such that there is no element G with this property for every I. Well, the idea is to enlarge the subgroup H naught. We replace H naught to by a bigger subgroup generated here. Generated by H naught and by this product, K products. You see, we choose this product so that modulo H1 we have these equations for arbitrary I. Of course, all relations of this form. All relations of this form will be preserved modulo H1 because H1 is greater than H naught. And so if our group is countable, if our initial group is countable, then we can enumerate all tuples of elements and construct such increasing series of subgroups and consider the union of all these subgroups A. And now modulo this subgroup, we have that for arbitrary K, there is an element such that given a set of distinct cosets, two sets, we have an element with this desired property. So the action of G on the set of cosets on X should be highly transitive. But the only question, what is this limit set X, who knows if H is just equal to G.
So what's the problem? This index has to be infinite of H. Is
that what the action should be faithful. So my misprint, intersection of all conjugate subgroups to H, G, H, G, inverse. I missed this formula. Should be trivial to have a faithful action. And if the action is faithful, then automatically the set X would be infinite. Well, And a few years ago, jointly with Yuri Bakhturin, we considered so-called action of maximum growth. We proved the following lemma in our paper. So that was not about highly transitive actions, but about actions of maximum growth. That given arbitrary finitely generated subgroup having infinite index in the free group, and two sets of cosets, pairwise distinct cosets, then there is an element in the free group and a finitely generated subgroup H1 containing H such that the index of this subgroup is still infinite, and modulo this subgroup we have this set of relations. This set of relations. H and H0, yeah, are the same. Sorry. Well, and so if we have that H is the union of HI, the action is highly transitive modulo H, right action modulo, if it is faithful. But it is faithful because it has maximum growth. Maximal growth. Now definition. Action of maximal growth asymptotically looks like free action. Maximal growth means that the Schreier graph, the graph of cosets, has maximal co-growth. The co-growth function. Co-growth function for arbitrary group. If you have a finite set of generators in the group and subgroup, then co-growth function counts the number of cosets of lengths at most n. At most n. And if we have a usual growth function with respect to A for G, then the co-growth of H is called maximal. If for some positive constant, we have this inequality. So the co-growth is almost equal to the co-growth of the trivial subgroup. In particular, since we know the growth of arbitrary free group. For free groups, a co-growth of H is maximal if and only if we have this inequality for some positive constant C. M is number of generators here. Example. Every finitely generated subgroup of infinite index has maximal co-growth in the free group. Here, just one example, a subgroup generated by A squared and B cubed. Why? Because in this graph, in the Schreier graph, we have a finite core. So finitely many loops generating the fundamental group. So, but index is infinite, so infinitely many vertices. So we have a core, here we have this core, and we should have trees attached to this core, and in such a tree, the degree of arbitrary vertex except for the root must be maximal, because all degrees in the Schreier graph I equal to 2m, 2m, and the growth of such a tree is maximal growth. So this is an obvious example of a subgroup. But we wanted to construct other subgroups with maximal growth. If you have an increasing sequence of a subgroup, then we have this obvious inequality for the co-growth functions. And to have the limit function. Co-growth is co-growth function counts the number of co-sets of H with lengths at most n. Co-sets. Arbitrary co-set has a representative. If a co-set has a representative of lengths at most n, then the length of this co-set is at most n by definition. So co-growth function, in other words, is the growth function of the Schreier graph.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Or growth function of the action, the same. Well, but we are able to control the co-growth, and for every epsilon, we are able to construct the next subgroup HA so that we have that Fi and Fi minus 1 are almost equal up to this epsilon. And since we are able to choose such epsilons smaller and smaller and smaller, we have for the limit growth function this desired inequality. So the co-growth is maximal for H, and it follows that the intersection of conjugate subgroups is trivial. It's trivial, so the action is faithful. Why is this trivial? Because if it is not trivial, we have a normal subgroup, non-trivial normal subgroup with maximal co-growth. But it is well known that for non-trivial normal subgroups in the free group, we always have inequality that the growth of the factor group, the co-growth is just growth of the factor group, does not exceed this exponential function for some positive epsilon. Positive epsilon. Yes, this mentioned in a survey of Grigorchuk and Delarpe, but it is a good and not difficult exercise.
But you can choose just one element such that the intersection
will be trivial. Yeah. But our approach makes possible to control some other properties. For example, we can add that for any particular element of the group, all G orbits for our actions are finite. And the property is based on one more lemma that given arbitrary finitely generated subgroup of infinite index in the free group and arbitrary element, then we can, the subgroup generated by H naught and by sufficiently high power of G has infinite index. So we use Bohr's lemma and again we should control the co-growth of the subgroups in our series and obtain. And Then I suggested to consider not free groups, but hyperbolic groups. Володя Чайников was graduate students of Vanderbilt University. So we take now arbitrary non-elementary hyperbolic group, that is a hyperbolic group which is not virtually cyclic. And one more natural restriction. If we have a non-trivial finite normal subgroup in an infinite group, then the faithful action, or just action on infinite set of this group cannot be too transitive. Even it cannot be primitive, because the orbits for our normal subgroups form an invariant partition, invariant under the action of the whole group. And therefore, we should exclude the groups with non-trivial finite normal subgroup. It's well known that every hyperbolic group has a unique maximal finite normal subgroup, so-called finite radical of G. And if we factor out this radical, we have almost the same hyperbolic group without non-trivial normal subgroups. And Чайников proved that given arbitrary non-elementary hyperbolic group with trivial finite radical, then G is a highly transitive group. Well, and a number of other properties following from his approach. Given arbitrary quasi-convex subgroup of infinite index, then it is contained in a bigger subgroup, so H is point stabilizer of our action, such that the action of G modulo, right action modulo H, is faithful and highly transitive. This action again has maximal growth, and therefore it is faithful. For arbitrary particular element, all G orbits are finite. And moreover, if we start with trivial subgroup K or with a free subgroup, then H, the point stabilizer, is a free group too, free subgroup too. Okay, so this is Чайников's theorem. He started with the observation that given arbitrary quasi-convex subgroup of infinite index in the hyperbolic group, it has maximal co-growth, and then he constructed an ascending series of quasi-convex subgroups with, again, co-growth control, such that the union has maximum co-growth in G, the action of G modulo H is highly transitive. Well, G is hyperbolic. Union is not, of course.
Each of them is
finitely generated. Yeah, each of H i's are finitely generated. Yeah, so.
There must be three products. So.
In particular, some side corollary, if you have and non-elementary hyperbolic group with trivial finite radical, then G has a maximal subgroup, which is a free group. Because if the action is too transitive, then the point stabilizer is always maximal subgroup. And in addition, again, a positive power of every element belongs to this subgroup H.
So, is this also true for like relatively hyperbolic and cylindrically hyperbolic groups?
Well, you are too fast. Well, yes. Cylindrical hyperbolic groups. Here's the definition due to Seller, Bowditch. I will not use this definition, so I will not read what is written here, but you can so this is definition of a cylindrically hyperbolic action of a group on a metric space. A group is called a cylindrically hyperbolic if it admits such an action on a hyperbolic metric space. And the action is called, again, elementary if the Gromov boundary has at most two points. Well, and all examples mentioned above of highly transitive groups of the second time, all of them are acylindrically hyperbolic, all of them. And there are many other groups, acylindrically, mapping-less groups are acylindrically hyperbolic, almost all fundamental groups of three manifolds, and so on. And the following theorem was announced at a seminar at Vanderbilt University 2 months ago by Denis Osin and Michael Hall. Since it is already written down, Denis gave me permission to cite this result, theorem here. So, and again, every non-elementary acylindrical hyperbolic group, again, having no non-trivial finite normal subgroups, is highly transitive. And again, the action is constructed as a limit of action. So, we have this increasing set of finitely generated subgroups. We take this union, and respectively, we start with some set X naught, G acts on X naught. Then we subject this X naught on smaller set X1, on X2, and we take the limit action and obtain this. They obtained this theorem recently. Well, but probably the second result by Hall and Osin is even more interesting. They proved that arbitrary highly transitive group, say finitely generated group, is of group of the first type or the group of the second type. By definition, the group of first type contains a normal subgroup isomorphic to this infinite alternating group. And the group of the second type it looks like a free group in a sense. More precisely, the universal theory with coefficients in G, for G and for arbitrary free product G times a free group, the same universal theory. Same universal. So this is precise definition. What is a highly transitive group of the second type? If G doesn't have a torsion, yeah.
Will it be then a limit group if it satisfies the definition of the second laws and also doesn't have torsion?
No. I
missed the question, but okay. Okay, so yeah, I have some time to continue. Definition. We say that an action of a group is locally finite if every orbit is finite. If every orbit. And two simple remarks that if we have a subgroup of finite index, then action of G is locally finite if and only if the restriction of this action to H is locally finite. This first remark. And second remark, if we have a normal subgroup in a torsion-free group and a faithful two-transitive action of G and this action restricted to H is locally finite, that H is just trivial. H is trivial. Again, otherwise, if the action is of H is non-trivial, we should consider the orbits, finite orbits, and this partition is invariant on the action of G.
What if H
equals
G instead? What?
Here, so I missed this case. If normal torsion free.
Maybe you want to do
it. Yeah, yeah. Yes. Propos. Mm-hmm. And I consider the question, is an action say a free group with the following antipodal property. On the one hand, the action should be infinite, so transitive on infinite set, on even highly transitive. And on the other hand, if we restrict our action to arbitrary finitely generated subgroup of infinite index, then we have locally finite action. So the restriction to arbitrary finitely generated subgroup must be locally finite. Of course, finitely generated subgroup of infinite index, otherwise it's not possible. If you have finite index subgroup with locally finite actions, the whole group has locally finite action. And only finitely generated subgroups, because, say, I cannot add any non-trivial normal subgroup to this list, again, according to the previous remark. And the answer is yes. And we use to prove, to construct such an action, I use the following property of free groups. So this is a theorem about a pair of two finitely generated subgroups of infinite index in a free group. Well, so this is not about Hahn-Neumann conjecture, but nevertheless about pairs of finitely generated subgroups. And I formulated as a theorem because During last year, I asked many people if there is a trivial proof of this statement. Still, I have no obvious proof. So,
could you extend this to the case if you take not necessarily finite degenerate subgroup, but any subgroup such that intersection of all its conjugate is trivial? To exclude normal subgroups?
Not. This moment I cannot do this. Too many such subgroups. So the theorem says that given a pair, of course together A and B can generate the whole group, but there is a subgroup of finite index in B such that A and C generate a subgroup of infinite index, in the free group. The application is the following. Well, we have a free group. We can enumerate all finitely generated subgroups of infinite index, B1, B2, and then we will apply the previous statement as follows. Let A1 be equal to B1. AI, we take the previous subgroup A sub I minus 1, and we take a subgroup of CI of finite index in BI, finite index BI, such that together they generate a subgroup of infinite index, Well, H is just union of all AIs. So H is a union of increasing sequence of finitely generated subgroups of infinite index. So the union must have infinite index too, because arbitrary subgroup of finite index finitely generated. Well, and it almost contains every finitely generated subgroup of infinite index by the construction. Almost contain. It follows that the right action of the free group modulo H for this right action, the restriction to arbitrary finitely generated subgroup of infinite index is locally finite. Because all point stabilizers would be almost contained in H. Well, we can again combine this approach from the lemma I formulated earlier. We can alternate our steps to construct a highly transitive action now, on infinite sets, such as restriction of this action to any finitely generated subgroup of infinite index is locally finite. Well, but you know that the free group is just saturated by with finitely generated subgroups of infinite index. And in addition, arbitrary action with properties A and 2 must be faithful. It is not difficult to prove. And again, so our set X is constructed as inductive limit of some sets Xi's well, and the last phrase here, that the point stabilizer for the action in the theorem is a recursive subgroup. So there is a machine. The machine can determine, given an arbitrary word, it can determine if this word belongs to the to H. It's recursive. The machine can do this. I cannot. I am not a machine. So I finished. Thank you.
You thought that if I take a subgroup, then there is a power of an element such that the subgroup generated by them is of infinite index.
Yeah.
That's what you said. So can I try something just to have a feeling? If, because if I have a free group on X and Y, and I take the subgroup generated by X, and I want you to give me a power of Y, such that the subgroup generated by them?
Yes, this subgroup is of infinite index.
Yeah.
Okay, I had exactly the same question. So you do it like